Hey you guys, so I know it's been a while, girl. This is part two of Ashes to Ashes. The reason why it's really taking me so long with this one is because you follow me on my vlogs, you know that we moved into an apartment. We are selling our house. We have a buyer on the market, amen. And so I've also been struggling where I wanna go with this particular storyline. I always know how I want it to end. It's getting to that end that could be the challenging part. So let's just go ahead. A recap of part one. We have Chrissy, who is a 20-year-old something mom, moving from St. Louis. Her and her husband, James, now live in a nice suburb of Denver. They have two kids. Chrissy is an LPN. I can't remember what James is. We'll come up with something. Her good friend Daphne just had her 30th birthday party. The next morning, unfortunately, Daphne's body was found on her front lawn. Her husband Montrell is devastated. So now we're gonna cut to a couple of days later after the death. Chrissy decided to take a couple of days off of work because she's just so emotionally overwhelmed with this discovery. She never herself has experienced death this close, okay? So Chrissy awakens the next morning and immediately she wishes she could go back to her dreams, because waking up is the real nightmare. She gets up, she sees that her husband Jimmy has already gotten up and taken the kids to school or daycare, excuse me. She rolls out of bed. Now, since the passing of her dear friend, she has been helping her friend's husband, since he is working still, and they have three children. And the children are devastated also. Three kids, Daphne and Montrell, have three children, all in the age of 10. So Chrissy, even though she can't really take care of her kids right now, she wants to provide extra support to Montrell. So she goes over to the house. The children, the 10-year-old is already off to school. Since Daphne was always at home, she never put them in childcare. So again, Chrissy agreed to go over and watch the children. So she shows up and Montrell is busy in the kitchen. She's like, "Hi Montrell, how are things doing?" And he's like, "Hey Daphne, you know, we're doing it day by day. And you know, thank you so much for coming over again." And Chrissy says, "That's no problem. It's no problem, Montrell. Whatever you need for me to do." He's like, "Okay, you know, it won't take me long at all. I just have to go to the office, pick up a few papers, and I promise I'll be back by noon." It's like 9 o'clock now. So 9 to 11, 3 hours is gonna be gone. He said, "Oh, by the way, my mother-in-law is supposed to stop by. And she says she has some papers and stuff that Daphne had let her have. I don't know what is it that she's dropping by, but just to let you know, Miss Victoria," which is Daphne's mom, "she's gonna be swinging by in like an hour." And Chrissy's like, "That's not a problem, not a problem." So Chrissy goes upstairs and the children are playing. Now these are young children, like 2 and 3. So even though they know their mom is not there, they can't really comprehend that their mother is dead. So she's just playing on, excuse me, has passed away. She's just sitting down and playing with them. That's when she hears the doorbell. Sure enough, it's a couple of, like an hour later, excuse me. So Chrissy goes downstairs and it's Miss Victoria, Vicky, which is Daphne's mom. Chrissy goes downstairs and she opens up the door and she's a little surprised, meaning Victoria, Vicky, is a little surprised to see Chrissy. She's like, "Oh, hey, Chrissy, I didn't know you would be here." She's like, "Oh, Montrell didn't tell you?" She's like, "No, baby, he didn't tell me nothing." So she's like, "Hey, where's my grandbaby?" She's like, "They're upstairs." So Victoria, she called her Vicky. Vicky goes upstairs to say hi to her grandchildren and they're still playing. After a few minutes, she makes her way downstairs. At this point, Chrissy is in the kitchen, you know, trying to get some stuff, clean up. Montrell had canceled all the, like they had like a house cleaner. He canceled all of that. Miss Vicky comes back downstairs. She's like, "My grandbabies, my poor grandbabies. I don't know what they're gonna do about their mama." Chrissy just doesn't say anything. And so she's like, "Well, baby, I really wasn't gonna stop by here long. I just wanted to give you some paperwork and I have this envelope that Daphne had dropped by the house a couple of months ago. So I figured, you know, maybe this is some stuff that Montrell could look through." And so Chrissy's like, "Oh, okay then, that's not a problem." She's like, "Well, there's something in here that has your name on it though." So Chrissy looks at her, she's like, "My name?" She's like, "Yeah, baby, I don't know what it is, but here you go." So she hands over to Chrissy a file folder. And sure enough, on the top is a yellow envelope that has Chrissy's name on it. So Chrissy says bye to Miss Vicky and she leaves to go back home because she's like, yeah, baby, I don't know what it is, but you know, tell Montrell that I'll come by again tomorrow. And so Vicky had to go ahead and head back home because her husband is about 15 years her senior, and he had suffered a stroke a couple of months prior, and just the news of their only daughter, Daphne, was their only child. So the news of this is really taking a toll on him. So she has to head back home to take care of her husband. So Chrissy doesn't know. She's looking at this folder and the file folders. She doesn't know she should wait for Montrell to come back and like a couple of more hours to open up the folder with him, or if she should do it, you know, now. So she looks at the folder. She's like, and she's thinking about it. She's like, I don't know if I should really open this up. And she's just thinking about it in her head. What should she do, right? So finally, after a couple of minutes, she's like, screw it. So she's kind of feeling around on it to see if there's anything. She feels something that feels like keys. And she's like, okay. So she opens it up. Inside is a memo of a bank, an address to a bank. And she looks at the keys and they look to be safety deposit keys. So she's like, this is odd. Why would her friend leave her keys to a safety deposit? So she puts it back, puts it in her purse, and she just waits for Montrell to come. Montrell comes back on time, honey. He doesn't delay. He's like, hey, Chrissy, how are things going? How were the kids? She's like, they were doing good. They're upstairs taking a nap now. She's like, and your mother-in-law did stop by. She has some papers. And he turned around. He's like, some papers? She's like, yeah, I guess Daphne had left her some papers and with a file folder. And that's when Montrell kind of looked at her. He's like, that's kind of odd. But yeah, he's like, you know what? Thank you so much. You know, I'll go ahead and take things from here. And Chrissy's like, are you sure? Because it feels like he's kind of rushing her out. He's like, yeah, Chrissy, everything's fine, you know. But if you can, is it okay if you stop by tomorrow, like around 9? Because I have to go back to the office. We have an emergency board meeting. And he's like, she's like, oh, okay, that's not a problem. Whatever you need, you know, to support you. So have you heard anything about the autopsy? I mean, do we know? He's like, I don't know. He's like, you know, I don't know. Just looking at her on that table. He's talking about when she was on the table in the morgue because he had to ID her body, okay? But anyway, he's like, it just looked like she was asleep. It just looked, she just looked like she was just resting. And so Chrissy just looks at him. She's not one to overly express herself, so she's just quiet. She's like, okay, well, please give me a call and I'll drop by a casserole later on. He's like, thank you so much, Chrissy. Thank you. I don't know what I would do without you. She's like, no, it's not a problem. So Chrissy goes back home. Jimmy is at home, honey. He's at home. And so he's at House Montreal. She's like, I think he's in shock. I mean, he's still busy with work, which I think is odd. You would think that even though with him being a lawyer that he would take some days off. He's like, yeah, Chrissy, but you know, sometimes people like to work through the pain. She's like, yeah, I guess so. And so again, Chrissy doesn't know she should tell her husband about the safety deposit key. And so she plays it off like she has to go to the grocery store. She's like, okay, Jimmy, I gotta go run to the grocery store. Is there anything you need? And he's like, yeah, can you pick me up a six pack of beer? And she kind of looks at him. She's like, are you sure you should be? And he darts her a look that makes her shut up. So she's like, okay, then I'll be back within an hour. So Chrissy is very, I wouldn't say the relationship is abusive, but it's very toxic at this point. Like I said, they haven't been intimate in 6 months. James has been on this whirlwind of comparing himself to other friends because he feels like at this point, at almost 30 years old, he should have been in a career and been more successful, quote unquote, but he hasn't. He's been working these dead-end jobs and went to college and all that, but he just hasn't been able to land that job he needs. And so Chris just was, he would just get any job. Any job is better than no job, but he's not willing to do that. He's just sitting at home, just depressed. You know, his pride is all over the place because Chrissy is the one that's been paying the bills and doing all this, whatever. So she ignores it. So what she does go to the store, pick up a couple of things, and she head immediately over to the bank that was on the slip of paper that was left in the envelope that Daphne had addressed to her. So she goes into the bank. One of the bank associates takes her back to a room to where the safety deposits are at. So Chrissy takes the keys out of the envelope and unlocks the safety deposit, and she sees another small box. She sets it on the table and she looks a little nervous. She's like, what could this be? So she opens up the box and she sees a bunch of like leather bound books. And there's another envelope at the very bottom. There's like three leather bound books. So Chrissy she ignores the books for now. She opens up this letters and it says to whoever's reading this, this is all the proof you need. And so Chrissy's like, all the proof you need. So she starts to open up one of the bound notebooks, and it's a journal. And the journal is dating back from almost 10 years previously. So she puts that one down and she opens up another one. The second bound leather notebook, is from the past 5 years. So then she opens up the next third notebook, and it's dated from the previous 2 years or so. But she just flips through, just looking through. She's not really reading, and she can't believe that Chrissy had kept these journals for like the past 10 years. Okay, you guys, so just so you know, part of this storyline is us going back, and Chrissy's gonna be reading some of Daphne's journal entries to figure out what's going on, and more importantly, to determine why she would let her have access to this safety deposit box and read all of these journal entries that are very private. So what she does is she goes ahead, she takes the notebooks, she puts the empty box back in the safety deposit box, and she locks it. So she goes back to her car and she leaves. While this is happening, there is another car parked outside. There is a man sitting in the car, and he's been watching Chrissy this entire time. He watched her go in and he watched her come out. So this mysterious man picks up the phone. He's like, hey, yeah, it's me. I just saw her. You're right. She went in and she grabbed some things. Okay, I'll let you know what happened. I'm gonna go ahead and watch her head home. I agree. We need to go ahead and figure out what was in that box. All right, you guys, that is it for part two. So just as a recap, there must be some information in these journals that Chrissy's going to be reading about what happened to Daphne. And part three will determine what the cause of death was. Chrissy's going to start reading in these journals, and we're going to be finding a little bit more information about Montrell, okay, and what was going on with his business, okay?